Hello and welcome to this session of Heart, Soul, Mind for 2020-2021 when we are reading together and thinking about Glenn Paauw's book, Saving the Bible from Ourselves. In this session, we will look only at one chapter of Paauw's book, Chapter 7, Our De-dramatized Bible. I think one of the most interesting sentences in Paauw's entire chapter here is the one that he quotes from the British scholar Barbara Hardy on page 106. She said, "We dream in narrative, daydream in narrative, remember, anticipate, hope, despair, believe, doubt, plan, revise, criticize, construct, gossip, learn, hate, and love by narrative." Paauw says, we just can't help ourselves. I think in many ways it's her first observation, we dream in narratives, that's the most interesting, because as psychiatrists and psychologists have helped us come to understand, dreaming is actually a mechanism by which we process what has happened to us through the course of a day. But we don't process it exactly by recounting the day. We process emotions, we process images, we process relationships. And yet we don't file those under those kinds of categories. We process them by creating new narratives separate from the ones in which we actually experienced all of those things. We dream in narrative. Narrative that we make up as a way of processing those relationships and emotions and experiences. For me, it's one of the most compelling examples of how it is that we humans are perhaps unable to help ourselves. We create narrative as a way of knowing who we are. And that's the point on which Paauw builds his insights in this chapter. He goes on to point out, or actually a little earlier in the chapter, he had pointed out that in the Hebrew Bible, in Israel's scripture, the Jewish Bible, our Old Testament, there's this grammatical construction called the vav consecutive. It looks like wow, the way he transliterates it. We don't have to go into why that's the case. It's pronounced vav, the vav consecutive. It's a grammatical construction that links together the consecutive phrases and sentences of a single story with this simple little Hebrew character vav, one of the smallest and simplest of all the Hebrew letters in the alphabet. But what it does is to create a chain of verbs that structure and lead the story from its beginning to its end. The example that I provide on your handout comes from a fairly obscure little narrative, just five verses in chapter 23 of 1 Samuel. My guess is many of us have never particularly read this. But you might want to follow along with me. Listen, in any case, as I read 1 Samuel 23, 1 through 5, and listen for how the sentences and phrases are joined together in this smooth English translation of the English Standard Version. "Now they told David, Behold, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are robbing the threshing floors. Therefore, David inquired of the Lord, shall I go and attack these Philistines? And the Lord said to David, go and attack the Philistines and save Keilah. But David's men said to him, behold, we're afraid here in Judah. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the armies of the Philistines? Then David inquired of the Lord again. And the Lord answered him, arise, go down to Keilah, for I will give the Philistines into your hand. And David and his men went to Keilah and fought with the Philistines and brought away their livestock and struck them with a great blow. So David saved the inhabitants of Keilah. We hear that as a dynamic, or Paauw would say, a dramatic story. Now they told, therefore David inquired, and the Lord said, but David's men said. Then David inquired, and the Lord answered, and David and his men went and fought and brought away and struck. So David saved. All of those conjunctions are the same thing in Hebrew, a simple and. But because of the way it's structured grammatically, it shows us that these sentences and clauses and phrases are joined together, chained together to create a dramatic story. And so the English translators rightly use that whole range of different conjunctions to demonstrate, to convey the dramatic dynamics of that story. You can see on the handout in the right-hand column that if we translated it more literally, it would simply say, and they told David, behold, the Philistines are fighting. And David inquired of the Lord, shall I go and attack these Philistines? And the Lord said to David, go and attack. And David's men said, behold, we're afraid. And David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered him and said, arise, go down to Keilah. And David and his men went and fought and brought away and struck, and David saved the inhabitants of Keilah. 12 times in these five verses, this little vav consecutive construction is used to chain together the verbs, to chain together the actions, to bind this story together as a single story and drama. That's what Paauw is talking about when he introduces us to the vav consecutive. Now, Paauw argues that this gift of narrative from biblical Israel, from the Jews who wrote this story and passed it on down to their community and to ours, that this creates the drama which is continued then in the New Testament for Christians. And Paauw tips his hand about what he sees as the through line, the arc of this story, when he says on page 107 that the power is in the drama as it witnesses to Christ and invites us to enter into his journey of new life. That's Paauw's narrative arc. Witnesses to Christ and invites us into his journey of new life. Now, to anticipate something of what we'll do next week, you can bet that that's not exactly the narrative arc that a rabbi or any of our Jewish neighbors would see in this powerful dramatic story. But that's getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, because I think Paauw's right that this dynamic of a dramatic story actually is what the Bible gives us, and it is in many ways distinctive among the monotheistic religions of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Not unique, but distinctive. Because this narrative, however we construe it in different the different faith communities of Jews and Christians, or even among us Christians, the different ways that we construe it. In any case, it's this story that tells us who we are and what the goal of creation is, where we're headed, what this is all about. Another one of the important things that I think Paauw tells us is that if we don't live by the biblical story, there are alternative stories being offered to us all the time that will give us a different identity and a different goal for life and creation. He names three: the nationalist narrative, the consumerist narrative, and the narcissist narrative. Now, here he does talk about meta-narratives, and he's using that differently from the way that I've used it in the last video, in the last session. His meta-narrative is really what we've talked about as the through line or the narrative arc, the basic thrust of what's going on. And he names these alternatives that give us different identities. So in a nationalist narrative, rather than the biblical narrative, which makes me a child of God, created in the image of God, heir of biblical Israel, called by Christ, redeemed by Christ, empowered by the Spirit of Christ. That's my identity in almost any biblical meta-narrative or arc. But in the nationalist narrative, I become a citizen. I become a patriot. I become loyal to a particular government and country, and therefore distinguished from all the other people in the world who are not part of my nation. That's a different identity, and it would have a different goal in life. Or the consumerist identity. This one's actually kind of fun to play with because we get offered this identity so often, anytime we watch television or drive down a road where there are billboards. Think about it. The basic structure of a television commercial is you have a problem. Dandruff, bad breath, body odor, a car that doesn't appeal to any of your friends, all sorts of things, cavities. You have a problem. We have a product. And if you buy our product and use it, there's a payoff. Problem, product, payoff. Basic structure of every sales pitch on television and in America generally. Because you are primarily a consumer. You're someone with problems that buying something will solve. That's a different identity from a biblical identity with a goal of the biblical hope for the kingdom of God. You can imagine too how this plays out in a narcissist narrative. You are your own person. You're the center of the universe. You have goals and aspirations and a presence in the world that needs to come to expression, needs to be supported, needs to be given its place. That's a different identity from the identity that a biblical narrative might offer us. So, Paauw wants to and will articulate for us what this grand drama is in the Bible. By the way, I think one of the things that we might do and have a little fun with is if after you watch the video and come into our discussion, look at television commercials, look at advertising in magazines or billboards, look around you and listen. Political speech is full of it too. What are the identities, alternative identities that you're being offered? And what is the goal that they suggest for your life as we can talk about some of those alternatives, we can recognize how different they are from the biblical identity we have. One of the people in our conversation last week said, "The world as I look at it out there just isn't the same world that I was taught as I was growing up and that I see when I read the Bible." I have to agree. In Paauw's terms, the narrative arc of the world that you're seeing and that is so pervasive right now, whichever one of these alternatives might be, it's just not the narrative arc of the Bible. So look for those. We can talk about those. As we move on into the next chapter, Paauw will offer us his understanding of the narrative arc, the through line, the story, as he calls it, of the Bible. One last point. Along the way of the story of the Bible, there are, I've said, half a dozen or maybe eight key stories to which so much of the Bible relates. And if we know what these, I think I'm going to list seven key stories, that if we know those, then probably 85 or 90% of the Bible will become much clearer to us, because we'll have these seven stories in our heads as part of our working knowledge that we use when we come to any other story in the Bible. They're also listed on your handout with general references to where you can find them in the Bible. I've also suggested that you might look these up in a Bible dictionary to get the overview that someone who's knowledgeable about the Bible has created to tell these seven core stories in the Bible. What do I suggest they are? They start with creation and move into the story of Israel's ancestors, Abraham and Sarah and the next three generations after them. Then, slavery in Egypt and Exodus from Egypt, that's the third one. Fourth, the Israelite monarchy, first united, then divided into northern and southern kingdoms, which set the context for much of Israel's prophecy. The fifth one, the exile and restoration, when Israel was taken from its land to Babylon, and then two generations later restored to its land. The sixth one, Jesus, and especially his passion, the story of his arrest and torture, crucifixion, and resurrection. All four versions of it in the four Gospels are worth taking a look at, but getting the basic arc. And then the early church and Paul, the most prominent of the apostles in our New Testament, probably best encountered in Acts 1 to 15 and in Paul's letter to the Galatians. It's not that other things are less important than these, but it is that these form a core of stories that keep getting referred to over and over and over again by other writers, later writers, not always used in the same way. It's fascinating that in the story of the Exodus in Psalm 135, 36, I would have to check that to be certain, but in the story of the Exodus, the people of Israel never go to Mount Sinai and get the Ten Commandments. Why is that? How is it that you can understand Exodus and coming to the Promised Land with no stop at Sinai? Well, if you don't know the basic story that's there in Exodus 1 to 15, you kind of miss something about what's going on in the Psalm. So that's why I'm suggesting those seven stories, one way or another, end up figuring significantly in so much else of what happens in the Bible. If you want a starting point for how to move into Scripture with more of this sort of the furniture in the room, the backdrop to so much that goes on, these seven stories can be a great starting point. There's some definitions on the handout. I've talked a little bit about some of those. I hope these continue to be helpful as you read through Paauw's book and encounter some of these terms that he sometimes explains, sometimes not so much. In any case, I'm certainly enjoying the conversations we're having, the places where Paauw and our discussions are leading us. I hope that's true for you as well. And I sure look forward to them for this week. Watch out for those alternative stories this week. God bless.